So it's a great pleasure to have Chi Wang, who will be telling about the simplex squeezing of domains in KISTAR-TM.
Okay. Thanks a lot for inviting me. Today we will talk about symplectic squeezing of domains in cotangent bundle of torus. Here's the background. We will consider two types of domain in cotangent bundle of torus, which are both traversable bundle of cotangent bundle of torus. The first is P2NR, whose the fiber is the standard simplex in Rn. The second is Y2NRV, whose fiber is minus R2RV times V perp. Here V is a unit vector in Rn, and V perp denotes the hyperplane that is perpendicular to V. For instance, when n is 2, V perp is a line perpendicular to V. See the figure. This is the fiber of Y4RV, fed tilted cylinder, which is bounded on the direction V. Note there are n minus 1 many unbounded directions in the fiber of Y2N. Now we talk about the rigidity on vertical cylinder. When V is 1000, we see phi pi one trivial simplectically embedding if phi preserve all the free homotopy class. Cyclo proves that C R is a pi one trivial simplectically embedding from P 2 N S to Y 2 N over to with respect to 1000 if and only if S is not greater than R. Miller is triangular and the trainer proves the stronger result that there is a simplex embedding phi from P2NS to Y2N, which induces an isomorphism on H1 if and only if S is not greater than R. This theorem only considers the case that V is 1000. The fiber is a vertical cylinder. To discuss the tilted cylinder, we need more torus. In general, Biron, Potorovich, and Stelleman define the capacity for the pair WA. Here, WA is alphabet-wise star-shaped domain in cotangent bundle of torus, and A is a subset of W. Alpha is a non-trivial free homotopy class. The BPS capacity is defined by detecting the dynamics of WA with respect to alpha. It is invariant on the pi one trivial simplectically morphisms. Only to calculate some cases that if V is rational, which means V is a scalar with pi of an integer vector alpha, then the BPS capacity of Y2NRV with respect to alpha is R times alpha's norm. Then we found an obstruction to the pi one trivial simplectically embedding from P2NS to Y2N. It's the BPS capacity of Y2N is finite due to P2N is bounded. If V is irrational, that V cannot be written as a multiply of an integer vector, then the BPS capacity of Y2N is always infinite. So we cannot find obstruction to pi one trivial simplectically embedding from P2NS to Y2NRV for original V. The discussion above is about pi one trivial simplectically embedding. If we drop the condition set of pi one trivial, we can indeed construct a simplectically embedding. This is our main theorem. Science question solution that we don't know the precise value of the BPS capacity of P2N, maybe it can be calculated similar to Y2N. This is our main theorem. We prove that if V is an irrational unit vector in Rn, then there exists a symplectic embedding from P2N R to Y2N when V for any positive R. The set of irrational unit vector is dense in the sphere of the unit vector. Here is a direct corollary of our result. Any bounded domain of cotangent bundle of torus can symplectically embed into Y2N when we, if V is an irrational unit vector. The symplectic embedding in our theorem is not pattern trivial. The special case that N is 2 resolves an open question posed by Gong-Xue, let V be an irrational vector but not an eigenvector of any matrix in SLC. Is it true that for any positive R, there exists a symplectic map from P4R to Y4 when V? Before we prove theorem, we will talk about a variant question. If N is not less than 3, instead of Y2N, the fat cylinder, we can consider another extreme case that the fiber is a thin cylinder. Denote X2N RW as a travel bundle of torus with the fiber DR times RW. Here DR is a disk of radius R in Rn, n minus 1 dimensional and perpendicular to the W. See the figure below. The fiber of X2N is a thin tilted cylinder, which is only unbounded on the direction W. If V is perpendicular to W, then X2N RW is in Y2N RW. So if there is an integer vector alpha perpendicular to W, then X2N RW is in Y2N RW, which implies the BPS capacity of X2N RW is finite. So in an opposite direction, motivated by our mean theorem, here is another question posed by Xue. He asked, suppose the DR contains no rational vectors at all. Is it possible that there exists a symplectic embedding from P2N R to X2N when W for any positive R? Here the condition that DR contains no rational vectors at all is equivalent to that W's complements are Q independent. There is a similar story on Gromov's non-squeezing theorem. If there exists a symplectic embedding from B2N R to B2N times R2N minus 2, then R is not greater than 1. Here B1 is in the coordinate of X1 and Y1. Which is a symplectic subspace. If we replace it by B2 in the coordinate of X1 and X2, which is a Lagrangian subspace, then there is no obstruction for R. So the bounded direction is important. Hofer asked a question that is, if there are positive R, such that the cylinder bounded in two directions, similar to Y2N, symplectic embedded into the cylinder bounded in X2N minus 2 directions, similar to X1. this question is solved by prior and non. There exists R such that the cylinder bounded in two directions can be symplectically embedded into the cylinder bounded in two minus two directions. So the number of the directions that are bounded may not matter. She asks a similar question that if we reduce the number of unbounded directions, can symplectic squeezing be still constructs? The domain we discussed before are bounded on the fiber, the Lagrangian subspace of T star Tn. It is distinct to the cylinder bounded on two directions, which is bounded on the symplectic subspace of Rn. Now we begin our proof of mean theorem. It contains three parts, and we will focus on the case n is 2. We began with the Arnold cat map. It will induce a symplectic morphism on cotangent bundle of torus in the form of phi a, which will deform the fiber of torus. More precisely, there will be two eigen vectors such that AV is lambda V. We can obtain lambda by trace and determinate. So one eigen vector lambda 1 is greater than 1, and another eigen vector lambda 2 is less than 1. Then the iterations of A will stretch the domain in Rn along one direction V1 and shrinks another domain. Shrinks the domain along another direction V2. Therefore, by Arnold cat map, we can simply embed any bounded domain into Y4 when V2. Here V2 is the eigenvector of lambda 2. This construction requires V as an eigenvector of some matrix in SLC. If A is in SLC, then its eigenvalues have to be an algebraic number solving the equation, which means the eigenvalue is the algebraic number. So the set of the eigenvector cannot contain all irrational vectors. To prove more general case, we need to take another sequence such that the map phi ai can maps p4ri into y4 when vi. Here vi is original vector appropriate to v. And the image of phi ai is in y4 1 plus delta i v. Here delta i is bounded. We show this relation in this figure. As I increase, theta I decrease, delta I increase. Our choice of AI guarantees us that when VI approximates irrational V, delta I can be uniform unbounded. Let V be a multiply of K1. When K is irrational, we will construct an approximation or direct it approximation theorem. This theorem says that for any irrational K, there exists coprime pairs Pi Qi. That is that Pi over Qi minus K is bounded by 1 over QI square. And the QI is goes to infinity. So the wanted unit vector VI is a rescale of vector PI QI. Consider AI such that PI QI times AI is 1, 0, and RI is the square root of PI square plus QI square. Then we can verify the length of projection along VI direction is less than 1. This means phi AI can embed P4I into Y4 1 VI. To obtain AI, that is the equation we will use Bézout's identity. For any PI QI, we can find the AI CI such that AI PI plus CI QI is the one. Which means PI QI times AI is PI QI times AI is 1 0. Then phi AI will map P4RI into Y4. In fact, we all can always embed phi AI of P4 into Y4 1 plus delta IV, where delta I is denominated by the rectangle spanned by VI and WI. Pair WI is a vector perpendicular to V. More preciously, phi AI will phi AI P4 is in minus 1 to 1 VI times minus LI to LI WI. LI is estimated by the longest length stressed by AI, and delta I is bounded by LI. If we can show delta I is bounded, then we finish the probe. We show this geometrical relation in this figure. This is P4. Phi AI maps P4 into this. This region is in the intersection of Y4 1 VI and Y4 1 plus delta IV. Denote theta I by the angle of VI and V. We have 2 times 1 plus delta I equals 2 LI times sin theta I plus 2 times cosine theta I. So delta I can be bounded by LI theta I. We estimate LI by the longest length stressed by AI. So it is bounded by PI square plus QI square. It is verified that phi AI maps P4 into the intersection of Y4 1 VI and Y4 1 plus delta IV. Recall PI over QI minus K is bounded by 1 over QI square. Now we can estimate delta I by LI theta I. Theta I is bounded by 1 over QI square. So delta I is bounded by PI square plus QI square over QI square. So delta I is bounded. Now we finish the probe. If V is rational, then we cannot apply direct approximation theorem. The accuracy of the approximation is about 1 over QI. So our approach fails for rational V. In higher dimensional, we can still use same approach. To obtain the approximation, the accuracy of the theta is about 1 over p to the power of 1 plus 1 over n. Here pi 1 is the complement of the rational vector vi, which is used to approximate v. By Bézout's identity, we can still have the following appropriation that for any coprime pi to pn, we can find a in is the LNC such that p1 to pn times a is 1 0 0. And the elements of the matrix can be bounded by the square root of sum of dk square. Assume this approximation, we can bound it Li by Rs square up to a constant similar to the case n is 2. So we can also verify that phi A can map P to N into the intersection of Y to N when Vi and Y to N when plus delta I V. And delta I is bounded by Li theta I. Here, delta I is not bounded as Li is about Ri square and theta I is about Ri to the power 1 to the 1 plus 1 over N. So delta is not bounded, but Ri over 1 plus delta is still goes to infinity. So we can prove the same result. We can discuss the new question about X2.
So we are a little bit behind. So do you mind leaving this to later part? I mean, you're like about minus 1 minute into your time. How much more you have to talk about?
There's nothing. It's okay, stop here.
Okay. Well, and we will have time at the end. Maybe if you want to really share something, maybe you can have a few minutes then. But let's thank Chi for now.
Huh?
Any quick questions for Chi?
Well, in the main theorem, you mentioned that the embedding is not pi 1 trivial. Is this something that's it's somehow obvious from the proof? Because I kind of missed it. Is it something that's easy to see?
To do what?
That, I mean, why is the embedding not pi 1 trivial?
Our construction is use the Arnold cat map. It will change the homotopy class, so it's not pi 1 trivial.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? I see none. Let's thank Chi again.